Welcome to a new test and teardown video. This time it's a signal generator from Datapulse. The model is a 110B. It's just called pulse generator. I believe this is an all transistor unit, so it's not super old. And I also believe this one was left a little bit outside in the rain. I found bird droppings and all sorts of disgusting dirt on it. Just to show you a little bit, I only cleaned this one a little bit here. Just to show you the difference. It's like really dirty. I think the output, look a little bit. I think this is the repetition rate. So this is the master signal generator setting. And we got a variable. And we got all the different frequency ranges. See, 50 hertz, 500 hertz, and so on. And then there's a last one that goes from 5 to 50 megahertz. So that means we got very fast repetition rates. Then we got some delay. And then a width. And I think this is the pulse. How wide is the pulse? And then we got positive amplitude and negative amplitude. You can even set the rise and fall time in different steps or in different areas, and then that will be the range for the fall, and that will be the range for the rise, I guess, right? And then we got the different outputs. Here is the positive, and here's the negative output at the same time. So it's actually very complicated or complex, this generator. We got synchronization output, and look, a negative 2-volt output pulse. Really? Single pulse or double pulse? So maybe that is the delay, that is maybe the time for the next pulse. I am a little bit unsure about that. We got enabling input, and then we got the trigger input. And I believe none of this is working unless you are in external trig modes. So if you are, in any of those frequencies up here, that means we are in running off internal like repetition rates, right? Otherwise the pulses, they will come when you come with an external trig. This is at least how I figure it out. Or you can, of course, okay, single cycle pulse here. So that is an internal kind of trig. Let's inspect the rear side. And yes, it is correctly set for 230 volts. I don't know if you can read this. And here's the nameplate, Datapulse, California. And that is the part number. That's interesting. Why is the part number different from what it says on the front? It's the model 110B. Why is this not a part of the part number? That's a little bit weird, isn't it? Well, it looks like it's got like really powerful power supplies. This one I need to fix a little bit, but I want to take off the lid before I power it up. I've been trying to clean up a little bit in here. It was really full of all sorts of dirt and dust. Have a look at this really well built unit. So that will be the rise time, fall time settings for the positive and the negative outputs. I believe we got some resistors in here. Some sort of a individual shielded rooms. Absolutely amazing design here. So that is a switch for the different rise times, and then how much variable. Let's look again here. See, no, this is, okay, this is amplitude. Sorry about that. My fault. So this is, of course, the different amplitude. Aha, so this is attenuators, right? And then variable output level. But here is the rise time, fall time settings. And that goes down here. And it's actually angled like this. This one goes a little bit sticky, so I think I will have to clean this a little bit so this go a little bit more smooth. So that will be the pulses going to the output amplifiers. I think it's like cascaded or paralleled push-pull stages. Remember, this one can go very, very fast. So it's nicely made with shielded cables and all that kind of stuff here. Beautiful, beautiful. And that will be the oscillator or the generator of the repetition pulses. And in this area, it looks quite all right. I've done a little bit of cleanup on, as you can see here, I'm not completely done cleaning up. It's still a little bit sticky and all that kind of stuff. This capacitor looks like it's a little bit swollen. They need to be completely flat here on the top, by the way. And this capacitor here, look here on the PCB around that capacitor. So this is leaked. So I need to replace this one. And I think I saw another one. Yes, this one also leaked. So I think if I just replace those two, I should probably be able to power it up. How about that one is maybe also... Yeah, oh, yes, see? Also leaked from the swollen one. Yeah, so I need to do that as well. And as you can see here, we got, I don't know, corrosion around everything here. I cleaned up this this track here. You can see corrosion between this track and the ground, and that was very, very bad all the way with the corrosion. So I bet this unit was actually powered up with some moisture in the dirt. So that is not good. But all those capacitors here, they're quite all right. Yeah, so that is my plan. And that will be the power supply, and that is a little bit of the bird dropping. Lovely. Oh my god. Yeah, rectifier diodes and all that kind of stuff. Those don't seem to be leaked, but we got a little bit of corrosion on the transformer. Yeah, so this one was left outside in the rain. Not so nice. I love this one. Okay, I needed to remove the bottom cover to get access to the capacitors and to do a little bit of service. And look at that. I got a coax cable that go in here. What do you think that is? I think that is a big reel of quarks for a delay line. Isn't that nice? Oh, look at that switch. And then you go with coax cables. I mean, this is serious, serious design. And then it goes, this is nice. How about we have a look in that one? Yeah. Intuition paid off. That is a whole reel of quarks. RG174. Isn't that nice? So that is a delay line for some kind of triggering probably, right? I better see if I can put this nicely back together. I think I got all the leaked ones out. You can really see got some nasty leaks here, and I definitely need to clean it up. And this one was all bad as well.
That one down here was super duper good. And the one here was a tiny little leak. Was that one? See, it's actually very, very close to an explosion. And then, see? Clearly leaked. So that is not good. And all this leakage kind of stuff is very, very conductive and corrosive. So it's very important to clean up. We got some corrosion stuff down here. I don't know if it's possible to see that. Oh, why wouldn't it focus on that? So I need to try and understand where that is coming from. But dirty that is, definitely. I think I will wait with all the rest of the capacitors that is not looking like they have leaked, because I just wanted to see if this unit is alive before I waste too much time. That looks like it's very close to the chassis. Safety distances, that is not something from the good old days, no? So after all the capacitor changes and all that kind of stuff, I am ready for the first power up. And, oi, 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 77 watts, are you kidding me? This can't be true. 73 watts. How is it using that much? But okay, you saw those big power supply heat sinks and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, maybe it is like that. But we got light, we got triggered. And what if I, oh, that is not normal. I would expect this trigger to stop. Oh, look at that. Single cycle. Hey, I need to boot up my oscilloscope. Oh, look at that. Maybe it's alive. I actually believe this thing works. What we have learned so far about the positive output and the negative output. You can set a baseline that is ground or variable. And here's the baseline shown. So here's ground, or it's positive or negative. For the positive, okay? So let's look on the scope. Variable baseline. See? This is the variable, the top one is the positive. And here I'm playing with the offset, and then I put it down to ground. And then this is the ground, of course, and this is the baseline of the signal, right? And this is the negative output over here, and it's doing exactly the same, right? So this is the level of the positive output and the level of the negative output. The rise time is quite obvious, right? So rise time of the signal is adjustable here on the variable, and the fall time is that one, see? And that goes, of course, the other way around when it's the negative output, but I think that is quite obvious how it works, right? So fall time, if we go like this, then it's turning more and more square. Then we go into the nanoseconds, and it could have been a little bit smarter if this was like a percentage of the repeat frequency. That means if I change now, if I want to achieve, let's say, the same kind of, oops, here, the same kind of curve like this, but I just want to go 10 times as fast. See? Then I go 10 times as fast, and then I also need to go 10 times as fast here, right? Oops, why don't we have a signal? Oops, there's a problem with the... Okay, that is the contact here is not so good. Here we go. Now it's working again. So of course, with a
much slower repeat time. Of course, I need to modify my scope setting here a little bit, and then modify the also that will give me the rise time and fall time I want, right? But then there's the width of the pulse, and here we go. Here's the width of the pulse. Let me try and play with that. More width, and then the variable. So then I can get back my signal like that, and then I can again get the wanted rise and fall times. There's actually another little funny feature this unit can do, and that is this pulse mode. And single pulse is what we see now, but we can also do a double pulse. So to be able to do the double pulse, I think we need to first use a much smaller width, okay, and then smaller rise time. Of course, here we got our pulses. Let's try the double pulse. Uh-huh. That is not working, right? Double pulse. Yeah, I think I know why. Because double pulse is not working when we are running off the internal oscillator. So let me try and use the external. See? This has also something to do with the tricked. So now we are using synchronized mode. So that means external, right? So now I'm playing with an external signal. I've adjusted the external trick sensitivity. And I can now play with the delay. Let's look at that pulse. And here's my delay. Smaller or longer delay between the two pulses. And I can, of course, still play with the width of the signal. See if the width is too wide. And then if I change, see, delay again, more delay. Oops, there's a lot of noise in the pot meter here, but you get the point. If the pulse is smaller, then whoopsie, this thing drowns. But anyway, I believe it works, but I got a lot of noise in the from the pots, so it was really good. I changed all those capacitors, but now I need to clean the pots and all that kind of stuff. Now I just don't know what to use this for, so I don't know. It was one night of playing around with some stuff. I don't really know what I can use this for, but at least it can do some pulses. The reason for this to go a little bit like that, it's because my trigger level, see? Oops. Yeah, that one is teasing me a little bit. It needs to be right for it to be stable. And then you got this green trigger LED. But anyway, I hope you had a little bit of fun after all. It is a very funny signal generator, and it is using only 75 watts. That is a lot. Let's feel a little bit here. Okay, that one is just okay. It's not even warm or anything. So